Hello and welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and together with our good friends at Linbit, we're getting into our third of this series where we're now looking at using LINSTOR to create our disk cluster. Now, pretty much the first thing that we want you to be able to do is understand the setup that we're using so you can follow through at home. So we've got one CentOS 7 host, which we're using with Ansible, so that can run a lot of our configuration for us. Once we've got everything set up, then we'll be working mainly with the LINSTOR controller that has both the controller and client installed. We've also another two systems installed, Satellite 1 and Satellite 2, and these, along with the controller, have the LINSTOR satellite service installed. Well, here we are in the happy land of, well, in this case, my Ansible host. This is CentOS 7, and we're using Ansible as our configuration management system. Now, this could be a good idea for you to get involved in Ansible, because Red Hat now are including an Ansible certification to become your Red Hat certified engineer. So your System Administration 3 can now be taken as an Ansible course and exam. So of course it makes it easy for your own environment. We've got multiple hosts to configure here, so that's really why we're using Ansible. But in your own environment, if you're not using Ansible, it becomes a good way to start to see how it can benefit. If we go through and look at our ordinary host file, we've got, well, our Ansible host, which is then just really our configuration workstation, but we've got the controller and two satellites. So we're going to be then creating a controller with three devices, the controller, satellite one, and obviously these are just host names, but the controller is going to be holding our configuration database, and a satellite can act as node. But we can also have a node running on the controller if we install the satellite service on the controller. If we take a look at how Ansible is going to help us, we can run the Ansible playbook command. We can specify an inventory, which is just a list of hosts that we want to run the playbook on. And then we can go through and specify the name of the playbook, the list of tasks that we want to run on our systems. So here we just called it host.yaml. So we can see then that we've got a list of tasks that need to be played, and then we play them on the designated hosts. This is also something called idempotent, which really means that the tasks only run once. But we have got some shell commands here, and those shell commands will run each time. But the configuration, such as installing the software, starting services, putting in firewall rules, only needs to happen the once. Now, if we take a little bit of a look at how Ansible is configured, we can start off looking at the inventory file and say we called that then our Ansible underscore host. So you can see that we've got the LINSTOR controller and the LINSTOR satellite 1 and satellite 2. The group name satellite and controller then can be used to identify these. We can also use a global group name called all for all hosts. The next part of the equation, if you like, is the YAML file. So we had the host YAML, and we can see, first of all, for that group all, so all of the hosts within the inventory, we're going through and installing wget. Wget, if you recall, is required for the repo script. The repo script creates our repo, and you can see that we copy that across from the Ansible host. Once that's all set up and I have to run that manually on each system, the repo script, we can then go ahead, as we did in the last video, looking at installing DRBD and LINSTOR satellite services on all hosts. Once that's installed, though, we are now additionally starting the satellite service. So we can see then that we're defining to start that. And just down the bottom there, we were looking at starting the DRBD service. Before we look at then enabling our firewall rule for port 3366, our satellite port. We then go for just the controller, where we're installing the LINSTOR controller and client, starting the controller, and then putting in the firewall rules. So we've got both TCP port 3370, which we need to enable. And then as we go down, we've got 3376. And on both sets of firewall rules, we're also then running that shell command firewall cmd to reload. We're setting permanent rules. We need to make sure that they are also then in transient by reloading that permanent database. Now, the next side of our configuration is to make sure that we've got clientless access. So it really requires that I can SSH into each of my systems without being prompted to accept the public key or through authentication. So I've already gone through and connected once and shared my public key so I can log on using SSH keys. So it's pretty simple configuration that we need. And there's no actual client for Ansible other than having Python on the systems, which is pretty standard in any case. So as far as Ansible is concerned, the only configuration that I've had to install is on the Ansible host. Using the Ansible client rather than Ansible playback, we can also then go through and reference our inventory, our list of hosts, and run a command. Here I'm going to say I want it run on all. Minus A then is followed by the command that I want to run. So we can verify, if you like, that everything is working as we thought by listing our TCP ports. So as we then go through and take a look at the output, here I happen to see it's satellite 1 and satellite 2 first. And when we look at the output, we can see that then port 3366 is open, but that is also open on the controller. But that's our satellite service, so we're listening with our satellite service. When we take a look at the controller, we can also see on the controller that we're listening on port 3370 and 3376. And that is then, or those ports are used by the controller service. And if we take a look, it's all Java that is running, but the process ID for both of those ports is 25353. So it is indeed the same process. As we go through, we also then configured the firewall. So if we go through and look at then our firewall-cmd, and we can use their minus minus list ports, well, you've guessed it, to list the ports. As we go through then the controller, we can see 3376, 3366 and 3370, so that configuration is right. And then on the two satellites, we've got 3366. Now, another piece of the configuration that we're not actually going to use within today's clip, but we are going to need later, is a backend volume group for LVM. So if I go through and look at VGS, a volume group scan, we can see that on all systems we've got, well, the CentOS volume group, so that was part of our installation, but then I've created a DRBD volume group on each system. We can see that's roughly 1 gig. The beauty of using LINSTOR is the LINSTOR client writes the configuration through to the controller pushes it out through to the satellites. The satellites then pick up the change configuration and they will create everything for us. So creating the back-end logical volume, which is going to be used then as our physical device to be represented by the front-end DRBD device, and we don't have to worry about the configuration at all. So we're ready then to connect into my controller to look at the configuration, and we do this through the LINSTOR client. If I run it just by itself, it's going to take me into the interactive client, and then I can start typing my commands. I get tab completion both in the interactive client, but also at the command line. Now, when I list my nodes, of course, I don't have any nodes at the moment. I'm just going to exit out, but I can also go through and run this directly from the command line. So this is good if I want to put in scripts or something like this, so I can do a node list. But if I don't want to have the verbose input, I can then go through and do NL to shorten it just to make my typing easier. And I do like my typing being made easier. But we'll be a little bit more verbose so we can see what's going on, and we'll create a node. We'll start populating our database. And we're going to add in our controller, and we're going to add this in as a combined node. So it's acting both as a controller and as a satellite. It doesn't have to, but we're putting it in then as a combined node. Once we've done that, we then need to go through and put in our host name, the host name that would be seen by the kernel. So I'm putting in then linstore-controller, doing my very best typing, and then the IP address that we can use to connect through to that system. And don't forget, of course, when we're looking at connecting through to the system, this is where then we need to make sure that the firewall ports have been opened. So we can go through then and set that up. And we can see then that we get some happy success messages coming back. I can then clear the screen and up arrow key. 162 then becomes the IP address that I'm using for my satellite one. So we can then go through to LINSTOR and then satellite. And one satellite, that's just such a terrible word. I'm English and I find that really difficult to spell. And of course then unknown type is also going to be satellite. But there we go. It looks like it's correct and it's accepted it. And again, more success message. My typing is getting really good these days. So then we've got 163. So that's going to be my satellite 2 system. And then the rest of it's going to be correct for it. So we've created our cluster, or at least the nodes that are going to participate in the cluster. We can go back now and just take a look at our listing of nodes and make sure that it all stays nice and green. So the controller holds the database, and we can see then when we're reading from that database, we know about our 3 nodes, and we can see the node types of combined and satellite. And don't forget, the combined type is both then a controller and satellite node. And they're all able to connect through because we've opened up the firewall ports. Don't forget that on your systems. That's then completed the first part of the configuration. We'll look at creating resources within our next clip. Now all there really left for me to do is thank you so much for taking time to watch this video. But don't forget to like, comment and subscribe. By subscribing, you'll be notified when we've got new videos out for you.